Now, I mentioned Kevin Roberts before lunch. Born and educated in Lancaster in the north of England, Kevin started his early career in the fashion house of Mary Quant. By the age of 32, he was CEO of Pepsi Cola Middle East, and in 1997, he took up his position as CEO worldwide for Saatchi and Saatchi, more recently becoming its executive chairman. A man recognized for his uncompromisingly positive and inspirational leadership style, he loves to focus on the irresistible. So our question of Kevin today is, with all the creative, innovative, and emerging industries out there, how can we get travel and tourism to stand out from the crowd and make our brands more relevant, inspirational, and irresistible? Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome a real force, Kevin Roberts.
Thank you very much. This is very unusual for me because 2 years ago, I was speaking at the Swiss Economic Forum in Interlaken, and someone in the audience said, "Wow, that was really good. I'd like you to come here and speak today." It's very unusual because normally nobody ever asks me to come back, ever. So thank you very much. And for the last 17 years, I've been running Saatchi and Saatchi. It's not the biggest advertising agency in the world. It's not the best, but it is the most famous. It's the only one that my grandmother had ever heard of. And it has quite a number of side benefits working for Saatchi, because we've helped put the conservatives in power, good thing or a bad thing. We've helped lose an election for Labour, Gordon Brown. Mind you, we think at Saatchi nothing is impossible, but electing Gordon Brown, yeah, that's very close to being impossible. But I get phone calls from all over the place, and a few weeks ago I got a phone call from the Pentagon, Washington, okay, Pentagon. It's not a great thing to have a phone call from the Pentagon, okay? This is not a thing that's very exciting. It's usually very scary. It means you can look forward to going to JFK and being strip searched and body searched for the next 6 months. Anyway, I rock up to the Pentagon and the guy has asked me, "We want you to speak about how to improve the image of America internationally." I said, "I don't think so." Nah. "You got the wrong guy. You got the right." No, we got the right guy. "You will come in 3 weeks' time, the Pentagon, and that's what you will talk about." I said, "Oh, okay. Who will I be talking to?" You know, we have any Americans brave enough to admit they're Americans? Any Americans here? Fantastic. Thank you very much. Okay, I feel amongst friends. Which was not like being in the Pentagon. Anyway, Americans have a very different way of speaking to Fiona, who is incomprehensible to most of us because of her beautiful Scottish accent. And me, we speak differently. Americans have different language. So I said to this guy, "Who will I be speaking to?" And he said, "Our best and brightest." Only Americans talk like that. So I said, "Okay, it'll be a very small room then." Anyway, it was a very big room. During this 3-hour meeting, there was a 4-star general there. I didn't know generals had 4 stars, right? I never met a general before. I thought they had 3 stars, but it's like hotels. They have 4 stars, 5 stars. And now, like Dubai, they will have 8 stars soon. So this guy with all these stars across his chest says to me, "Listen, we live in a VUCA world." Oh, wow, man, what's that? I said, yeah, I know. But, you know, I knew that. A world that is volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. Volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. Unless, of course, you live in Switzerland, and none of those apply. But for the rest of the world, for us poor people that don't earn Swiss francs, we live in a very volatile, uncertain, complex and ambiguous world. So for example, we have worked with the Ritz-Carlton, one of the great brands, for many years. And we also work for Home Away. So we work for, if you like, the old leaders of hospitality with the new leaders of the sharing hospitality. So it's quite complex and ambiguous dealing with that. So I said to this general, okay, that's what you may think, but actually, we already know that, and we live in a world that is super VUCA. Because I'm in advertising, and everything is super. It's super league, super size, super model, super everything. And I said, the world that we see, actually, is a world that is vibrant, full of life, full of hope, full of optimism, full of vigor, full of energy, full of change. It's a vibrant world. It's a world that is unreal, unreal. Because in the past, to change this world, you had to have power, you had to have resource, you had to have money, you had to have people, you have to connections. Now, doesn't matter. All you need to change the world is an idea. An idea. It is ideas that are the currency of this world. We are in the ideas business. We're in the ideas of disruption, the world of disruption, of transformation. It is a world, a super VUCA world that is crazy. Now I'm seriously fucking crazy. Okay? I am seriously crazy. I have no fear of anything. I started life very poor. Now I'm very rich. Being rich is better. Okay? So I have no fear of this stuff. I don't care. I have survived. Darwin is dead. We're alive. Crazy. And you need crazy people. Because to work in a VUCA world and a super VUCA world, man, in the age of the idea, you got to be crazy, because it is not about process. It is not about management. It is not about all the theory and all this stuff, because in a VUCA world, good luck. Five-year plan? You're kidding me. No plan ever withstands first contact with the VUCA world. Have a plan B, you're wasting your time. Okay, have a plan A and then fix it immediately, because it's gonna screw up, okay? Get going. So you gotta be crazy, and it's a world that's astounding. It's astounding because you can change this world overnight thanks to Apple, Steve Jobs, thanks to YouTube, okay? Thanks to Instagram, thanks to Facebook. If you have an idea wherever you are, you can change the world overnight. We have moved into a world where we live in the age of now. It is not about being new. We're all bored with new. By the time you think something new, your 20-year-old son has already been stealing it, ripping it off, and doing it for 3 years. By the time you first heard about it, okay? They've already given up on iTunes. Everybody's on Spotify. Everybody's on the pirates. Nobody's paying anymore. Okay, so we live now in the age of now. We no longer live in the attention economy. It is not about getting attention. We live in an economy that is driven by participation. We must participate. We must join in. Feeding the swans is not participation. There must be something better than that. We do not live in the information age. We are all drowning in information. The stats and the travel business are horrendous. I know more than I ever want to know about this business of yours. We all know the same stuff, and none of it really matters. Okay? Google, Google, boom, boom, boom. Information is nothing. What matters now is inspiration. How can we inspire people to be part of this group? How we can inspire people to get excited about what we're doing. Interruption is out of the question. It is interaction. ROI. I read so much stuff on ROI from Marriott and from all these people. Every company I know has a formula for ROI, a return on investment. Every company, from Etihad, from Emirates, Qantas, maybe British Airways doesn't have one, but should have one. So everybody has an ROI, right? And they're all the same. They work half of the time, and the other half, they're useless. Edward de Bono, right? The guy who wrote your lateral thinking and white hats and black hats, all kinds of hats. He once said to me, Kevin, there is no point being brilliant at the wrong thing. ROI is the wrong thing. The real ROI to measure success, to predict success, is return on involvement. How involved will our customers be with our brand, with our country, with our hotel chain, with our airline, with our restaurant? How passionate will they be? How involved are they going to be? Anybody here in marketing, raise your hand, please. Thank you. Marketing is dead. Not because you raised your hand, Fiona. Not necessarily. No, but marketing as we originally learnt it from Philip Kotler or from Peter Drucker or from Procter & Gamble or whatever, about, you know, creating a brand and creating demand and creating awareness and getting the product right and the price, all this crap. That is all table stakes now, okay? The role of marketing is not to build a brand. In fact, brands are dead too. Brands are dead. Poof, they've become commodified. Everything is a brand and nothing is a brand. Hillary Clinton is a good example of both. So, the role of marketing has changed now, not from building a brand, but from creating a movement. And travel, tourism is a fantastic movement. And all of us need to come together like this. It's great that you're all here to see that, because together we need to make travel a fantastic movement, a movement that brings everyone great jobs, great careers, great opportunities for entrepreneurs and for management people too, and brings nothing but joy and happiness to the world. That's quite a challenge. I live in New Zealand, okay, which makes Switzerland look like a very big country. So I live in New Zealand, and this is how we deal with challenge in New Zealand.
A new haka for the All Blacks.
So brands are dead. To win today, you've got to become a love mark. You've got to be not only respected, you've got to be respected and loved. You've got to move not from being irreplaceable, because everything today can be replaced. One destination can be replaced by another. One mountain can be replaced by another mountain. One lake by another lake. To be irresistible is the key. This is what irresistible feels like. Sir, Scotland, sir, how do you get started? Well, three ideas. Idea number one, okay? All right, you got to reach for the stars. Martin Luther King, he's dead now, okay? But you remember him. He did not say, I have a vision statement. I have a mission. No, he had a dream. What is your dream? What's the dream for your business? We all want to be part of something bigger than ourselves. We don't want to be part of a strategy, an objective, or a goal, or all this nonsense. We want to be part of a dream. We want to be part of something bigger than ourselves. Do you have a dream? Does your airline have a dream? Does your hotel chain have a dream? Are you going to try and make the world a better place for everyone? Are you going to try and make the place a better, just better? The second thing we've got to do is make magic. The CMO, the chief marketing officer, is now without a job because marketing's dead. Luckily, we're going to make you a new CMO. You will now become the chief magic officer. And instead of doing marketing, you will make magic. And we will make magic for all of our people because revolution starts with language. And the language in our business is very generic, is very hackneyed, is quite dull and is quite predictable. It's all very informative, but not terribly, terribly uplifting. Magic is all about having lots and lots of small ideas continuously. It's about the Tom Peters idea of fail fast, learn fast, and fix fast. If it slithers like a snake and it hisses like a snake, it's probably a snake. Do not call McKinsey snake department. Do not Google snake. Kill it! Fix fast. We're doing a lot of things wrong. Let's stop having meetings and having discussions. Kill the snake. Get on with it. In this magic world, the chief magic officer has got to surprise with the obvious. Surprise with the obvious. We work for Home Away. How obvious is that, you know? People have got houses. They don't live in them all the time. They want to share them. Bang. That's obvious. Airbnb, Home Away, obvious. Now, wasn't at all obvious a few years ago. And we've got to reframe constantly. Steve Jobs reframed presence into absence. He took away everything. Took away everything. Hard drives, floppy disks, CDs, and charged us a fortune for it. And we were grateful. All hail Steve. Okay. Uber moved from taxis suck to Uber rocks. Okay. They just reframed the whole business. New Zealand, we reframed from being a boring sort of fishing country into an adventure destination. Three secrets to making magic. Infuse everything you do with these three things. Mystery. The more we know about something, if you've been married for a long time, you know exactly what I mean. The more we know about something, the less interesting it becomes. Okay? People want to be involved. It's no longer a one-way conversation. It's not about storytelling, in fact. It's about story sharing. We don't want to be told a story anymore. Okay, we want to share the story. We want to be part of the narrative. We want to participate. Stories no longer have beginning, middles, and ends. No, they don't. They're an ongoing conversation, an ongoing narrative that we want to have with our customers, our clients, our fans. Sensuality. It's operating on all five senses simultaneously, not just operating on one of those senses. We feel the world through all five senses. Have a look at your communication. Have a look at some of your terrible websites, which are full of information and all very helpful and very boring. Very boring, especially the ones from Germany. Of course, they have an inherent disadvantage, which is called the German language, but never mind. Intimacy, the third thing. Intimacy is feeling empathy, feeling close, walking in someone else's footsteps, not telling them, not giving them. But intimacy is very dangerous. It can go too far.
Summer arrives, and they come with it. Men stripped of everything, even their own pride. They have no pants, no shame, and less self-respect than clothes. Along with the heat comes every family's worst nightmare. Dads in briefs.
Two takeouts, because we have to walk talk or talk walks or something. I can't remember which way it was. Okay, the first talkout's in talent. We've got to inspire great talent to join us, to stay with us, and to do themselves, to create that. I have 75,000 people work for me. Actually, that's not true. 75,000 people are employed by me. I'm not sure how many of them are working. But we give them four things every day in equal parts: responsibility, learning, recognition, and joy. Responsibility, learning, recognition, and joy. We give them, they give us, we give our peers, they give customers, customers give them, all in equal parts, all at the same time. If you do that, you have a very happy workforce. And happy bunnies work harder than unhappy bunnies. Right? Yes. Responsibility, learning, recognition, and joy. Second thing, sustainability. Everybody talks about sustainability, right? Including you guys. It's so boring. You know, you go to Copenhagen, you go to Brazil, we have meetings, we have conversations. Nothing happens. Politicians talk. Nothing. So we are very simple at Saatchi. We're very simple. We have a program called DOT. Do one thing. Then we ask everyone to do one thing, and then we have another program. Amazingly enough, it's called DAT. Do another thing. So when you leave today and you go back to your homes, your kids, your loved ones are going to say, "What did you do all day?" And you're going to be embarrassed because you sat here. So it's kind of embarrassing, right? Well, you know, I changed the world. So when you go home to your children, here's one thing that you can tell them that will make a difference.
Pessoas que são metade homem e metade monstro.
Coisas do além.
Leis brasileiras.
Leis gregas.
Pessoas boas.
Pessoas não tão boas.
Gênios da arte.
Gênios da ciência.
Trapezistas. Amantes.
Pessoas de outros planetas.
Fenômenos do cinema.
Enfim, se você faz xixi, tá convidado.
Faça xixi no banho.
So you can save the rainforest just by peeing in the shower. Thank you very much.
I'm not going to attack you, I promise. I thought, isn't he amazing? Doesn't he give an amazing insight? And doesn't he challenge our thinking? Kevin, I know you all want to ask questions, so I will. We've got some of the guys in and around that can pass on the microphones. But Kevin, you've talked about, and you're in the business of inspiring people, and we've already said you're known for being an inspirational leader. But what actually inspires you?
Change, transformation, invention. I love, my purpose is to try and make the world a better place through business. And I love seeing people like this come in here to change and be transformed and do things differently. And that really excites me.
And what is it about you that people say you're an inspirational leader? And don't be modest. I know you're not the modest type anyway.
Everybody loves me, baby. What's the matter with you?
What can I say to that? Thank you for that one. Okay, now I'm going to put it out to the rest of you. Okay, Kevin has already said that he is prepared to answer any question.
One thing you got to do when you're here. I went last night to a 2-star Michelin restaurant called Focus. It's in, what's it called, that place at the far end of the lake, Vitsnau, the hotel park. The chef there is amazing. He cooks only local Swiss produce, mixes things like beetroot, rhubarb, carrots, all from down there. A guy has a wine cellar there, 3 million bottles. He's got verticals going back of Lafitte, Latour, Yquem into the 1800s. He has one bottle, €650,000. So I put that on the conference. We had that last night. I just signed it to the to the conference. You would have enjoyed it. It was very good. But this is Switzerland at its best. He's a young guy, 34, fantastic place. And he did everything right. At the end of this meal, we were at the chef's table, just the two of us in his kitchen. It was 1:30 in the morning, we're going by, and they said, how are you going to get home? And I said, the guy's going to get me a taxi. The chef said, that's ridiculous. The hotel car will take you back to Lucerne. The hotel car was not there, okay? I don't know where it was. And I said, a taxi's fine. The next thing the chef says, well, I'm going to take you. I live here, but I'm going to take you to Lucerne, the chef, and I'm going to drive back here. And I said, you can't do that. He said, I'm going to do. We walk outside. We get in his car. This is Switzerland, right? Maserati Quattro Porte. Eh? Chefs. Tourism. Yes. Go to Focus.
Okay, Kevin, let's put it out. Who's got some
Sarah.
Questions? We've got a gentleman over there.
Right. Since you aren't afraid of anything, just think nobody's in the room and there's no Swiss people here. How would you position Switzerland, period?
Yeah. I used to live in Geneva, so I have tremendous admiration and respect. I was there for 8 years. I know Geneva's not really Switzerland, okay? I understand that. I got that. It's like New York and America. But I think that at the very essence of Switzerland now is our people. You know, you can talk about the lakes, you can talk about prices, you can talk about quality, you can talk about all this tourism stuff. People like all that, but people love people, okay? When people go to Australia or Brazil or to New Zealand, they talk about the people. And I think what Switzerland needs to do is it needs to go on a charm offensive of friendliness, friendly taxi drivers, friendly passport people, friendly waiters. We already have one friendly chef, so I think it should go to charm school. We should open up charm school for Swiss. Roger Federer is quite, you know, he's very charming, no? Pretty good forehand, too.
Okay, great.
About the people.
Kevin.
Yeah, who else has got a question?
Yep. Oh, I feel okay. Like Elvis. Uh-huh. Tell me, a tip. The hacker. As a rugby player, I know it. But the French response to the hacker, you should look that up.
Yeah, I've seen it.
Because that's something different.
Yeah, it's tremendous.
Crazy.
You know, the hacker is the Maori war challenge, and the All Blacks and all the schools in New Zealand do this before a game, and many opposition have a response to it. The interesting thing, I was on the board of the All Blacks for 5 years, is we don't do that to intimidate. We actually do it to bond together, to remind ourselves that today we will spill blood together against the enemy, and this is a reminder that we share our values together. That's at the essence, but there are some great responses.
Any more questions from the audience? Well, I've got one final one for you, Kevin.
Are you allowed?
Yeah, I'm allowed. We've got a lot of young talent in the room today. We're deliberate. This forum is about mixing the inspiration of leaders with future leaders and the young talent that's coming through. What would be your advice to them?
There is no such thing as young talent. Everyone here is young, because young now is what you feel in your heart, what you have in your head, and down here as well, right? Young now is really a state of mind, and some people who are young in age are already old in experience. So I think it's the same advice to everyone, which is start with the answer and work back, right? If you don't know where you're going, all roads will take you there. So start with what the movement is you're trying to create, and then make the big decisions with your heart and the little ones with your head. Thank you very much.
Thank you.